Bible says, we're lamps to our feet and a light to our path. That ought to be all of our prayers. That the Lord would order our steps. Amen. We give God praise for the voices of the United under the direction of our minister of music, Brother Dion Davis. Amen. Father, we thank you and we praise you for another opportunity to be able to share your word. As always, we're leaning totally upon you to open up our understanding and make us receptive to your voice. As I decrease, you increase. I sit down, you stand up, that your people might hear and see you in the spirit. Your word go forth with so much power and conviction that the lost will be found, the wayward would be restored, and the faithful will be encouraged. And when you do these things, we're going to be so careful to give your name all the praise, honor, and glory. For it is in Jesus' name we pray. Keep your God safe. Amen. 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 You have your Bibles, and you will turn with me to the book of 2 Samuel, the 11th chapter. 2 Samuel, chapter number 11. When you have it, if you would stand in honor of God's word. 2 Samuel, chapter number 11. Amen. Second Samuel chapter 11, and we'll begin reading at verse number 6. Second Samuel chapter 11, verse number 6, we find these words. And David sent Joab, saying, send me Uriah the Hittite. And Jacob sent Uriah to David. And when Uriah was come unto him, David demanded of him how Joab did, and how the people did, and how the war prospered. And David said to Uriah, go down to thy house and wash thy feet. And Uriah departed out of the king's house, and there followed him a mess of meat from the king. But Uriah slept at the door of the king's house with all the servants of his lord, and went not down to his house. And when they had told David, saying, Uriah went not down unto his house, David said unto Uriah, camest thou not from thy journey? Why then didst thou not go down into thine house? And Uriah said unto David, the ark and Israel and Judah abide in tents, and my lord Joab and the servants of my lord are encamped in the open field. Shall I then go into mine house to eat and to drink and to lie with my wife? As thou livest and thy soul liveth, I will not do this thing. And David said to Uriah, tarry here today also and tomorrow, and I will let thee depart. So Uriah abode in Jerusalem that day and the morrow. And when David had called him, he did eat and drink before him, and he made him drunk. And at eve, he went out to lie on his bed with the servants of his lord, and went not down to his house. And it came to pass in the morning that David wrote a letter to Joab, and sent it by the hand of Uriah. And he wrote in the letter, saying, set ye Uriah in the forefront of the hottest battle, and retire ye from him, that he may be smitten and die. You may be seated in the presence of God. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers, the hearers, and the doers of his word. For a few moments, we want to share from the subject, when your cover is blown. When your cover is blown. Of all the stories in the Old Testament, for some reason, this one literally breaks my heart. This one depicts the lengths that we in our human nature will go in order to keep up the fronts in our lives. I don't know about you, but for me, this story of David and Bathsheba is a story of man and his words. A story by which a man willingly wallowing in the soup of sin. Truth be told, this was the tipping point of David's life. This great king of Israel, whose love for God was unprecedented. You do know that David was a man after God's own heart. But by now we see this man of God as he fell prey in an awful sin. You all know David's story. Oh yes, and David was very well aware of his position as the chosen one of God. You see, Judah, the great-grandson of Abraham, was given an explicit pledge that a promised ruler would come from the line of Judah. Samuel anointed David as the one. And David knew the theological significance of his election as part of the messianic line that one day would lead to the birth of the Messiah. Amen. And so David lived a life that was pleasing to God. You all know his record. As much as Saul set out to do wrong against him, David had opportunity to take Saul's life, but he didn't. The Lord blessed David. He was able to defeat a lion and a bear and ultimately won victory over Goliath. Yeah. But now here in the text, we see that something happened on a fateful day that would be the turning point of David's life. And as a result of one very bad decision, David's life of triumph turned into a life of tragedy. This event was the starting point of a series of events that David would have to endure. It was the beginning of a nightmare existence with a lifetime penalty. David's sin nature took over, and he allowed the lust of his flesh to forever impact his remaining days on earth. And if we would just be real this morning, all of us at some point can identify with David. What I mean by this is more than a few of us can think of at least one bad decision that changed our lives forever. It could be a multiplicity of things. Maybe it was a bad marriage. Maybe it was an unexpected pregnancy that has you strapped for child support payments. Maybe it was a traffic ticket for drinking and driving. Maybe it was a misdemeanor that netted you a hefty fine or some community service. Maybe you made a decision to drop out of school and get a job only to find out that no one hires people who quit school. Whatever the mistake is that you made is certain, listen, it's certain that you paid a heavy price for it. And I want you to know that that's just what sin promises to those who dare to indulge in it. Sin will entice you with this cunning deceit. And then sin will cause you to fall into a bottomless pit of I told you so. And so as we examine David's fall into sin, I noticed three warning signs that we ought to heed to. Three warning signs that if David had heeded to the signs, he wouldn't have been in that predicament. There are some signs of sin that we should all look for whenever we find ourselves in a sinful predicament that will forever change our lives. And so we might as well just start praying right now, because I'm not only preaching to you, but I'm preaching to me as well, because you do know that as long as we live, we're going to have to deal with sin. As long as we live, we're going to be tempted, but there are some things that we ought to look for that will help us along the way. And so the first thing we see is that sin causes us to be derelict or neglectful in our duties. Say that again. Sin causes us to be derelict or neglectful of our duties. In other words, sin throws us off track. Look at what verse number 1 in this passage says. It says, "And it came to pass, after the year was expired, at the time when kings go forth to battle, that David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel, and they destroyed the children of Ammon and besieged Rabbah, but David tarried still at Jerusalem." Now the first sign of sin was that David shirked his own duty. He shirked his own duty. He neglected his own duty. You know, David would have never been tempted if he had gone with his army, because that's where he was supposed to be. Rather than to lead his soldiers into battle, David chose to stay in Jerusalem. A closer study will reveal that it was springtime and the rainy season had passed, and it was customary that to resume military activity. The Ammonites were still hostile toward Israel, and David knew he had to do something about it. And so he ordered Joab to launch an invasion of Rabbah, the capital city of Ammon. Though kings usually led their armies personally, even if you look at our own history, whenever we went off to battle, we had generals who led the way. They didn't send their troops, but they led their troops. And though kings usually led their armies personally, David chose to remain in Jerusalem. The scripture gives us no definite reason for David shucking on his duty as king and commander-in-chief of his armies. All we know is that David sent his soldiers into battle and he did not go with them. And my brothers and sisters, that's just how sin usually finds its way into our lives. It waits for an open door. It waits for a vulnerable point in our lives. It waits until it can get in, a chance to slip in the almost undetected. Think back over your life. You knew you should have gone straight home to your family, but you thought that you would just stop and have one drink with the boys and it would be no big deal. You knew that the girl at the end of the bar was making herself available, but you just wanted to have a little conversation. You knew there was something fishy or something just not right about that phone call that was coming in, but you decided to pick it up anyway. You knew that the guy was trying to push up on you, but you continued to make small talk. Help me, somebody. You knew you should have carried your behind home, but you continued to make convenient excuses to be where you were when you knew you shouldn't have been there. You should have been at home. Where are my real folk at this morning? Where are my real folk who know they saw the smoke, but they had to get a little closer, and as a result, they ended up getting burned by the fire? I come back here to let you know it's the little thing. It's the little thing. Those things that cause you to neglect your responsibility, but it can end up becoming a trap door. If David had gone into battle with Joab, he would have most likely have returned victorious because God was with him. He was the apple of God's eye. God had not failed him. If David had been where he was supposed to be, he probably would not have been tempted. And how many know it's the same thing with us? When we're obedient, the Lord blesses us. David should have went with his army, but instead he chose to stay behind and take a stroll out on his rooftop. And it was an evening stroll. Perhaps it was a chance to catch the evening breeze. But how many of you know David caught more than he bargained for? Have you ever noticed that it's not until when we're not where we're supposed to be, that's when we wind up
in trouble. It's not until, oh, help me somebody, it's not until you're somewhere where you ain't got no. Listen, the Lord already brought you up out of it. You should have stayed out of it, but you decided to go and have one last. Where you're not supposed to be, that something or someone catches our eye. And what caught David's eye is what we call today eye candy. Y'all better start praying. You all know what eye candy is. Just as sweet as candy is to our mouth, eye candy is just as sweet be a number of different things. Eye candy for the young men can be the new LeBron James. That's eye candy. It can be that new car. That's eye candy. But eye candy is not just something that that's pleasing on the eye. Y'all were praying this morning. I said eye candy is not just something that's pleasing on the eye. But how many know eye candy just might be somebody? Oh, let me help you out. You see, let me tell you. On average, the Lord blessed us with two eyes. On the average, all of us have this. And if you like me, you got a little extra. It's okay to see things. But see, seeing is not the problem. See, it's all right to go shop. Just don't buy. See, you get a whole lot of folk. You see, just as sin makes us neglectful of our responsibility, I see something else that happened with David. Verse number 2 says, and it came to pass that at evening time, that David arose off his bed, and he walked upon the roof of the king's house. And from the roof, he saw a woman washing herself. Now that's enough, but this is what the Bible says. It says, and the woman was very beautiful to look upon. The Bible said that. Let me tell you something. I'm trying to look over at the family. For some reason, I keep getting distracted over here, y'all. From this verse. Woo! From this verse, we see that sin causes us to be desperately desirous. In other words, we can't just look at stuff. We just got to have it. In other words, we began to covet what we don't have or what we think we want or need. David took one look at Bathsheba and he couldn't control himself. Bible says she was too beautiful for him to look the other way. In other words, he looked at her and he was so mesmerized. I'm trying to paint a picture for y'all. She was just too beautiful. I keep trying to tell y'all that sin is pleasure. Sin is, let me tell you, sin is, there's no sense in us talking about, oh, sin is ugly and sin is this. Listen, sin is pleasurable. That's how sin gets you. It entices your senses and it tantalizes your flesh. Sin makes itself so tempting and alluring and attractive that it's hard to say no. You know, I thought about something. Besides the fact that man says many sins are unlawful, what I mean by this, you can't go to jail for buying a bottle of liquor. You can't go to jail for buying pornography. You can't go to jail for having an affair with another man's wife. But when we open the door for sin to enter, it becomes so desirous of all that it legally has to offer, even if it's not beneficial or advantageous for us to indulge, and we soon find ourselves under the controlling power of sin. And I tell you something else. Sin attracts sin. And guess what? Sinners attract sinners. That's why Paul warns us in 1 Corinthians the 6th chapter. Paul says, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Now watch this. What was Bathsheba doing bathing out in the open, knowing that she could be seen from somebody's window? See, we want to just talk about David's sin, but let me tell you something. She has to be equally culpable. It takes two to tangle. And I don't know, but maybe she was hoping that the king would see her and invite her to the palace. Both of their actions were inexcusable. David had more than enough time from his initial inquiry of Bathsheba and his invitation to join him to rethink his motives and gain control over himself. David could have saw her and he could have been like Pastor Dick's turn and went the other way. He should have went in the house and slammed the door and shut down the shade and sent one of his handmaids to go tell that woman to... Y'all know I'm telling the truth. David knew that adultery was sufficient cause for execution, even for the king. But it amazes me how desperately desirous we become when we think nobody's watching. One of the things that get me the most about folk today, especially leaders, they get caught doing some of the dumbest. Oh, I'm going to just try. I'm sorry. Listen, in this social media world with all these many faucets of communication, we still have folk getting tripped up because they don't think nobody is watching. They don't have any safeguards. Let me tell you something. I done put folk on notice. Don't be sending me no friend requests. If you my wife's friend, you already my friend. Oh, y'all better hold on. Oh, listen. We got too many folk to get tripped up thinking nobody can see what they're doing. Facebook and Instagram and tweeting and cell phone cameras. And it's only a matter of time before everybody have a body camera. It's gotten to the point to where I know I can't and I don't judge nobody. It's only the grace of God that's been keeping me. But let me tell you something. For the past 3 years, I can't tell you the number of folk I have counseled because their relationships were at risk. Their job was on the line. They were in all kinds of trouble because of something they done out there on Facebook. You can't hide it. Well, folks see what you're doing even when you don't see what you're doing. Somebody's always watching. There's hardly anything we can do, any place we can go, anybody we can talk to without somebody seeing us. So here we find that sheep bathing in the nude, in the open outdoors, as if no one would see her. And then we see David's attempt to cover up everything, to keep folk from finding out. Did David forget that God was watching? It's apparent that he did because of the actions that he took, which brings me to my final point. Sin causes us, first of all, sin entices us. It causes us to neglect our duty. Then, sin causes us to be desirous of that very thing that we know we ought not get into, but then I see something else. Sin will cause us to be deliberately deceiving. Amen. It's one thing to be just deceitful, but it's another thing to be deliberately deceitful. This is the point at which you know you are completely controlled by Satan, that father of lies. Once you find yourself knee deep, or better yet, let me say neck deep, that's when it's cover up time. This is when the sinner becomes so intertwined with his or her sin that they spend an enormous amount of time covering their tracks. They use one cover-up after another cover-up to hide their sin. Look at poor David. He tried everything he could to pull the sheets over his own adulterous affair with the wife of one of his closest confidants. You see, when Bathsheba dropped the bombshell that she was pregnant in verse 5, David, instead of trying to face up to his sin, instead of owning up to what he did, David tried to legitimize his sin. Let me tell you something, we can't make wrong right. I don't care how many times we try to do it. Beginning at verse number 6, in an attempt to cover up his sin, look at the series of actions that David took. First of all, he brought Uriah home from the battlefield, assuming that Uriah would run to the arms of his wife. And David and Bathsheba would be the only ones who would have known that the baby that she was carrying was not Uriah. And so David's original cover-up attempt, when it didn't work, you see, it didn't work because Uriah was honest. Uriah was a man of integrity. He decided that it would be wrong for him to go home and enjoy the comforts of home and enjoy his wife while his colleagues and his friends remained on the battlefield. And so when this plan didn't work, the text says in verse number 13 that David got Uriah drunk. Wow. News that inundated about one of our famous fathers and comedians that was his. We ain't gonna talk about it. You know, slipping the Mickey or whatever they call that stuff. So David thought he could get Uriah drunk, hoping that would be the magic touch that made Uriah run and enjoy the intimacies of his house. And the plan would have worked if Uriah was not so devoted to the king. Notice the distinct contrast between David and Uriah. One is deliberately deceitful, while the other one is decidedly devoted. So you got deceit against devotion. David's sin took him down a path of destruction, not just his own, but ultimately Uriah's. For when the plan fell through, David took even more drastic measurement. In verses 14 and 15, when he had Uriah carry his own death sentence back to the battlefield, don't tell me what you can do under sin. You're no match for the enemy. You get to get off into something that you think you can shake off, and you find out that thing got you so deep until you not only destroy your life, but you destroy those who are around you. Oh yes, we think we can cover up a lot of sin in our lifetime, little ones and big ones. Most of our sin seems to go unpunished. We tell a little lie here, we pinch a little theft there, and because we do it in the dark, it never seems to make it into the light. We think that it's okay, but the question I want to ask right now is, what happens when your cover is blown? What happens when the cover comes off? And I want you to know right now that sin is never okay. And you need to know that God punishes sin. And I may as well get in trouble right now. I'm sorry to disappoint the politically correct folk, but yes, you are right. There is no such thing as a sin that cannot be forgiven. But what y'all fail to understand is that forgiveness does not absolve us of the consequences of sin. Yes, you'll be forgiven, but let me tell you, you're gonna pay for some of the stuff that you've done. Let me see if I can make it a little plainer. You run a red light, you go to court, the judge has mercy on you and doesn't add points to your driving record. But guess what? You still gonna have to pay a fine. Or it may be this, your boo man or your little princess is constantly getting in trouble at school, and as much as you love them, as much as you want to give to them, my grandmother said you still got to bust their hand pot. They have nothing to do with how much you love them. You have to pay for whatever it is that you do. And so we find that later on in Psalm 51, that David repented and was restored to fellowship with God. But the impact of his sin remained. and will continue to work in sorrow in the nation of Israel as well as in David's own house. We find that the prophet Nathan told David that the sword would never depart his house, and it was not long before heartbreak, before death, before rape, before murder, all that stuff began to happen in David's house, and he couldn't deal with it correctly because of the sin that he committed. You see, if he had to remain the apple of God's eye, he had to remain faithful to what he was supposed to do, and he had to remain what he was supposed to do and been where he was supposed to be, none of that would have taken place. And so as I close, I want to leave you with this. It's possible to suffer without sin. Let me say that again. It's possible for us to suffer without sinning. Why? Because bad things happen to good people all the time. But let me tell you something. It's not possible to sin without suffering. And I want you to know that there's a price to be paid for our sins. There's a burden to be borne. There's a shame to be endured when we sin. There's a joy to be lost. There's a relationship to be severed when we sin. There's a sense of guilt to carry. And there's a judgment that we have to face when we sin. And the worst part about all of this is sin separates us from God. Let me tell you something. It's one thing to commit an act of sin, but it's another thing to be in a lifestyle of sin. It's one thing to just do a sinful thing and to repent, but if you're in a lifestyle of sin, that means you're doing it constantly. You wake up doing it. You go through your day doing it. You lie down doing it. You're just in a sinful lifestyle, and there's nowhere that God can be where sin is. You're separated from God when you sin. In other words, our deceit separates us from God's truth. Our hatred separates us from God's love. Our darkness separates us from God's light. Our injustice separates us from God's justice. Our devilishness separates us from God's divinity. But I bring you some good news this morning. We can't avoid the catastrophes of sin. All we need to do is heed to the warning sign. Don't be neglectful of your duty to God. Don't be neglectful of your duty to your family. You got to remain committed to your responsibility. That just means be where you're supposed to be. Do what you're supposed to do. Say what you're supposed to say. Listen, don't be desperately desirous of something or someone that you know you don't have no business embracing. Rather, you ought to be content with what God has already blessed you with. You got to be content with whoever God blessed you with. You got to be content in whatever state that you're in so that you don't fall into sin. And then don't be deliberately deceiving others to try to cover up your sin. You're already in trouble. Why make it worse by trying to cover up? You already told one lie. Now you got to lie to cover up for that lie. Then you got to lie